encourage students and postdocs to spend some time in Washington every now and then, because it does help that fund projects that are very beneficial for science. The second thing I wanted to mention is that we have a new administrator starting today. Her name is Janet Sartor, and she will be sitting in the office over there. If you have anything administrative, feel free to visit her office.
Nice to meet you.
And so we'll start with the scientific program. Lisa.
So it's a pleasure to welcome Professor Norman Murray from the University of Toronto. Professor Murray is a fellow Caltech alum, after which he got his PhD at the University of California, Berkeley. After two more postdocs, one of them was again at Caltech. He took up professorship at the University of Toronto, and specifically at the Canadian Institute for Terrestrial Astrophysics. Of which he's been the director for a number of years. He's
Pastor.
Discovered many different topics in his career, ranging from star formation and galaxy formation to active nuclei, and also dynamics, planets, exoplanets, heliophysics. He will be giving ITC luncheon talk about a different topic, which is molecular gas in simulated galaxies. This is on Thursday at the ITC. And today here, he will tell us about tidal disruption events.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for the invitation. And I should say, this is a black hole institute. This talk is only peripherally in a way related to black holes. I'm mostly going to talk about astrophysics. But in principle, I think in practice, you know, these sorts of observations where people discover these tidal disruption events will tell you about the demographics of black holes. Started here. I'll show you some of these plots again later. So I'm going to talk about the optical emission from tidal disruption. Okay, so show only star messages. That's interesting. I don't know what that is. Okay. So this is the outline of my talk. I'm going to talk about a little bit about preliminaries. Then I'll go through a fair amount of the phenomenology of tidal disruptions, because I think I'm an astrophysicist. I'm a physicist by training. The reason astronomy is fun because it requires a lot of physics to understand. So the phenomenology is very rich, and that's certainly true of these tidal disruption events. And I think it helps you understand what's going on. And one of the main problems in the topic is what's called the energy problem. If you disrupt a star and it falls down the black hole, if there's any kind of reasonable accretion efficiency, or say 10%, you should get a lot of energy out if you disrupt a solar mass star. It's 10 to the 53 Earths, basically. And the events that people identify as tidal disruption events typically have total energies coming out in the optical and the UV, basically the volumetric luminosity. They're much smaller than that, typically 10 to the 50, 51. Some of them reach as high as 10 to the 52 or total. And then, given that phenomenology, I'll make a number of inferences. I'll describe how you do this pretty straightforwardly, I think. You do measure the luminosity and the effective temperature of the radiation, because these things are covered now well enough by different bands. You can very quickly, you'll see that they're black body spectra. And that gives you the photospheric radius. The emitting region has a certain size. It expands and contracts very slowly, typically, compared to the velocities at the radii where you see these things. And that's a big clue. It was very puzzling to me. They also clearly drive massive winds, essentially broad absorption lines, broad absorption line quasars. Okay, and I'll tell you what a broad absorption line is and what a quasar is. Okay. And in fact, I'm going to make the argument that the winds remove most of the mass from the star. When you have a tidal disruption, of course, about half of the mass is ejected right away and put in hyperbolic orbits. The other half is bound in these highly eccentric orbits. Most of the wind that is in those highly eccentric bound orbits, most of that mass is carried away by the wind, I claim. Okay. And so you don't have much of the bound mass accreting, and that leads to these low energies. But combined with the fact that, in fact, most of the stars, as I said up here at the top, what's the mass of the median star? It's not a solar mass. Okay. All right, so let's jump into it then. So the first thing is, that thing's still there, I wonder what that is.
And you need to click on it.
Well, you can't during this slide talk. So this is just showing, so for the non-astronomers in the room, stars come in different masses. They're born, clusters typically. If you just try to say how many masses are there, how many stars are there of a given mass when they're first born, that's called the initial mass function, the IMF. And this is showing the integrated or cumulative initial mass function. Okay, so I'm starting out here at very massive stars, and I'm just showing you what fraction of the total stars that are formed have a mass greater than a certain amount. So very few stars have, this is one solar mass, that's a tenth of a solar mass, and a hundredth of a solar mass. Very few stars have masses bigger than that of the sun. Okay, in fact, the sun only accounts for maybe 10%. The sun and all stars heavier than the sun is only about 10% of stars.
Okay. But burning does not take place below 7%, right?
That's okay, it doesn't have to be a star.
Okay,
the
so
IMF goes on
object.
Down. It's just an object with hydrogen and helium and stuff in it, yeah.
Okay.
You're right, it's not a star in the sense that it doesn't burn regular hydrogen, will burn deuterium down to lower masses than that. But that's okay, right? What you see is the debris. You don't see the light coming out of the star itself, okay? And the point I want to make, these are just a few different people have different estimates of the initial mass function of stars, but Chabrier is one of these, and then Krupa, there's a few other ones. But the point is here that your median star, you know, here's half, is either a tenth of a solar mass or two-tenths of a solar mass, okay? And I think that's been underappreciated by people who work in this field. You don't expect solar mass stars to be the things you see disrupted. You expect tenth solar mass stars. That's already a factor of 10 difference in the luminosity and the energy that you expect to get out. Okay? That's a big part of that energy problem. Okay, so what kind of image should you have in mind? This is going to be kind of annoying. Maybe I can get rid of it. So this is a simulation by Shiel Kao et al. Of a couple of years ago. This is in fact a simulation of a white dwarf, a very compact star, being disrupted by a 500 solar mass star. Okay, their argument is the reason they did this, of course, is that there's a smaller range than in the radii that they have to cover, so it's computationally less expensive. So it was a good strategy. And their idea is that, you know, more or less you can scale this to the actual events that you have. And in the actual events, instead of having this black hole has got a 500 solar masses in it, and the ones that we think we see, they're more like a few by 10 to the 6, 3 by 10 to the 6 solar masses, 10 to the 7. And the stars are not white dwarfs, we don't think. They're not necessarily main sequence stars, but they're not as compact as white dwarfs necessarily. So this tau is measured in units of the orbital period for the most tightly bound orbit, essentially. So this tells you how it evolves with time. And what I want you to just take away from this is a face-on picture. Okay, so you form a disk. And this is the column density, essentially, that we're showing here. So this is evolving with time. And then this is an edge-on picture. Okay, and the idea here is that, first of all, this thing has a quite extended atmosphere. You can see here, this is in units of M, the mass of the central black hole, so converted into distances. But the point here is that this scale is, you know, 400 m, and this scale, this is at 4.9, so I just look over here. This, you know, 400 is about like this, right? So that it's a fairly spherical object. I mean, it's flattened, but it's not really razor thin. So, phenomenology. So the first detections where people suggested that they were tidal disruption events were done with ROSAT back in the 90s. And then there wasn't much data available from that. I'll show you a little bit of that. More recently, there's been a lot of optical surveys, PanSTARRS, the Palomar Transient Factory in various iterations, and ASSASSIN, the Ohio State effort. But both the X-ray and the optical detection show critically a rapid rise in the luminosity, sort of weeks. And then a slow decay, it's going to be months or years. So this is the next slide, showed one of the old, this is a compilation fairly recently, of some old data. This is X-ray flares, seen by ROSAT. scale is in years, but the rise time here is typically, the sampling wasn't that great, but you know, months or something like that. And then this decay takes years. And they fit, I think, a T to the minus 5/3 power law there, and there's some theoretical explanation for that, which I won't go into. And the luminosities in the X-rays are of order 10 to the 44 for just the red points here, and about 7 by 10 to the 42. And this is in soft X-rays. So the temperatures of these X-rays are typically, in astronomers' units, 50 EV, I should say. So very soft X-rays. Okay. And here's a similar set of light curves for in the optical for more recently discovered objects. So this is a very famous one, Ghazari et al. This is the rise in the luminosity coming up, and then it tails off. And again, this is a logarithmic scale here. So this is, 100 days, and this is 2, 3, 4, 5. This is about 2 years later. Okay. And there are X-ray upper limits for this object, which are much lower luminosity than the optical for this event. Okay. And on the right, there are a bunch of, those are for individual bands in the optical and some near UV points here. Those are pretty good black bodies. You can't tell from that plot what they are. And so if you fit a black body, you can get the bolometric luminosity out. And here's a plot showing a number of objects. Their light curves as a, their bolometric luminosity as a function of time. And the point is that they're all decaying on timescales that are, in this case, hundreds of days. These are assassin objects are usually found when the things are very at the peak brightness, so you don't see the rise at all. So you don't see this part of the curve. All right. Okay. So the luminosity in both those X-ray and optical sources is between 10 to the 42 and 10 to the 44 Hertz a second. All right. Even in the X-rays, when they fit them best with black bodies. So it's thermal radiation. In the optical, the effective temperature is between 10,000 and 40,000, depending which object you look at. And in many cases, it's very little variability. At the most, it's a factor of 2. And that's very surprising if you know about things like supernova, because normally in supernova, the effective temperature drops like a rock with time. Okay, these objects, it doesn't. I already mentioned this, it's 40 to 50 EV for the soft X-rays. So this shows, again, from mostly assassin data. This is time, again, on this axis, and the scale here is 100 days. And this is the black body temperature. For this object, it was around 20,000. And for this object, it was closer to 40. And most of them are pretty level. This green object did increase in temperature by a factor of about 2. So that's the upper limit to what's been observed so far. So they're very good, steady. There's some sort of thermostat operating. While that's happening, of course, this is over 100 days, the luminosity is dropping by a lot, okay? So if it's black body emission and the temperature's fixed, if the luminosity is dropping, this emitting area has to be decreasing, all right? So here's a plot showing the radius of the photosphere in nice solar units, solar radii. This is about, in CGS units, around 10 to the 15 centimeters. And again, it's just showing that the radii are dropping, which is explaining why what you infer from the black body radiation keeping the same temperature but having the total luminosity decrease. Now, I put this plot in to show you, in some objects, you see both X-rays and optical. So here's the optical emission. This is wavelength here. So in the optical, what we see is sort of in here, right, several thousand. 8,000. And those are points at different frequencies, and the different colors correspond to different times. And over here is the X-rays. They're also detected. And this plot is lambda times log lambda, which is telling you the amount of energy. So this peak being higher by more than a factor of 10 than that peak tells you that there's a lot more energy coming out in the optical, like more than a factor of 10, about a factor of 30, than there is in the X-rays. Okay? But if you look at other objects, that ratio can vary. All right. So here's an example of another object, Assassin 14 Li, where the showing you the UV and optical data in these sort of gray points here, and the X-ray data in the blue crosses. And you can see there they're the same luminosity. And they track each other very well. Okay. Now the other thing that's of interest, at least for this talk, I'm supposed to end it at 2 o'clock, is that right? Maybe a little bit.
4 or 5.
2 o'clock, okay, well. Okay. They do show, if you take spectra, you see broad emission lines, several thousand kilometers a second. So this is, again, the plot that I first put up. So here's a spectrum of this particular object, Pan-STARRS 1, 10JHJ, I forget which one it is. So this is a plot of the flux at the detector on Earth as a function of frequency. The red line here is the spectrum that you'd expect from the galaxy that it's in. So when you go down like this, you tend to be kind of reddish. If you're going up in this direction, you're very blue. This object was very blue when it was very bright. Okay, so that means it's a high effective temperature. And the model that they're fitting this with, this blue line here, is 30,000 Kelvin. Right? But what I want to point out here is there's this very broad emission line right there, which is interpreted in this paper as helium-2. But the width corresponds to about 5,000 kilometers a second. Here's another object, more recent data. Again, helium-1 and helium-2 seen in emission, and you see these broad emission lines. And I interpret that as due to a wind coming off the surface of this object. Okay, if you've got an object which is 30,000 Kelvin and it's quasi-spherical, if I didn't tell you anything else in your astronomy, you'd say, well, that's an O-star. And O-stars are known to have winds coming off them. They're driven by line, radiation pressure on lines, which I think is what's going on in these objects. All right, the last thing you can infer, not very reliably, I'd say, is the mass of the central black hole. Sort of probably the most reliable way is just to measure the mass and velocity dispersion of the stars in the host galaxy, and then use one of these observed correlations between the black hole mass in galaxies where you have a pretty direct measurement of the black hole mass and either the stellar mass or the stellar velocity dispersion of the host galaxy. Okay, and those estimates give you things like the black hole mass is somewhere between 10 to the 6 and a few by 10 to the 7 of most of these objects. So here's just a plot taken from a recent paper showing that. There's the black hole mass, 10 to the 6, 10 to the 7, 10 to the 8. These are various objects. And as I said, the error bars tend to be pretty big. These are coming mostly from velocity dispersion measurements of the stars in the host galaxy. And they're a few times 10 to the 6 solar masses up to 10 to the 7. Okay. Now this bar is telling you the bolometric luminosity at its peak brightness. And it goes up to a little above 10 to the 44. So that's the Pan-STARRS object I was talking about. That's the only one that even approaches Eddington. The rest of these objects are all sub-Eddington. And what does Eddington mean? It just means if you've got a star and it has a certain mass and a certain radius, you know, there's gravity pulling it in. It's also got light coming out of it. If the light is interacting with the matter, which it will be because these stars are hot enough, these objects are hot enough that they're basically ionized, there's radiation pressure arising just from the photons that hit the electrons, just from Thomson scattering. Okay, and that provides an outward pressure. And when you reach the Eddington luminosity, if you make the star bright enough, it'll start to remove the layers of the gas. Okay, these objects are all below that limit. The radiation pressure on the electrons by itself won't drive gas off of these objects. So now I'm going to start making a series of inferences from this data. Okay, as I already mentioned this, the spectral energy distributions, that's what this says, this, just the shape of the spectrum, is a black body. Okay, and you can measure the shape of the spectrum, that gives you the temperature, and you can measure the total flux that you receive in your detector, and you know the distances to these galaxies, so you know the luminosity. And that allows you to calculate the radius of the photosphere. You can do this for different bands. So that's the distance of the galaxy. That's the, you know, the astronomer's notation for the flux coming out of a black body. And that's the measured flux. Okay, so you know everything on the right-hand side. You can figure out what the photospheric radius is. And you can do this at several different bands. And you know they are consistent. All right? So you do really get the radius of the photosphere. And it varies from about 10 to the 13 up to 10 to the 15 centimeters. And it varies with time. So that was that plot that I was showing you earlier did this. Now, if you do this at different times, you can measure the radius of the photosphere at different times, you can just do a, you know, a derivative, and you can calculate what the velocity of the photosphere is. And typically, it's 100 to 200 kilometers a second. Okay, in the same objects that you see line widths of 5 to 10,000 kilometers a second. Okay, so basically, they're well below the escape velocity. And what that's telling you is that these objects are in hydrostatic equilibrium, I think. Okay? I see Abby nodding his head. This story is familiar to him. Okay. So I did this with Linda Struba in a paper. This is, again, that Pan-STARRS object. The different colors here correspond to different colors, literally, right? So this is the photospheric radius with two different estimates for the black body temperature. And you see that, you know, the thing got brighter and then it got dimmer. And the temperature always stayed the same, roughly. And the velocity here was 700 or 1,000 kilometers a second while it was expanding, while it was getting brighter. And it was several hundred, maybe 100, 175 kilometers a second while it was getting dimmer. Okay? And you see similar things for more recent objects, these Pan-STARRS objects. Occasionally you see one that really drops rapidly. And that's an interesting case, actually. I won't discuss any further, but these are the estimates, 110, 200. This particular one gets up to 4,500 kilometers a second. So that is approaching free fall at that point. All right. So I already said this one. These tidal disruption events have massive winds, okay? But you can actually calculate their mass loss rates directly from the observations that I've just described to you, okay? Because you know that the dominant opacity in the continuum is electron scattering. If they have winds, you do have to worry about lines covering some opacity, but that doesn't make a huge difference in this calculation. So basically, when you see the photosphere of a star, that's the region where photons can, you know, get out to your eye without scattering. So the optical depth is of order unity. Right? The chance of you hitting something is one or less, maybe a half, say. All right? So the optical depth is just the path length times the density times the opacity of whatever it is that's causing the absorption. In this case, it's electron scattering, so that's this kappa ES. So kappa ES times the radius times rho, that is equal to 1. So that's why I just inverted this. Rho is 1 over kappa ES times the radius. This is a measured quantity now. So now we know what the density is at the photosphere of this object. Okay? If you know what the density is, and you know that you've got a wind with a velocity given, again, by the measurements, by the line widths, you can calculate the mass loss rate. It's 4 pi r squared rho times the velocity, assuming it's a spherical object, which it isn't quite, but it's not so far off either. Just remember those images I showed you at the beginning. So that gives you a mass loss rate of 10 to 25 grams per second. Okay? So, yeah?
You talked about the line width.
Yes.
Now you're saying that that is the wind velocity.
Yes, I am.
Is that line really shifted by that much?
So when I realized this several years ago, I realized that you should see Pisigny profiles in the UV.
Okay.
They are there.
They are there.
And the winds are several thousand kilometers a second.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm kicking myself. I didn't write all this up a long time ago because the spec I hadn't seen it, but they're there.
Yeah.
You don't have to know anything except you know about O stars, right? If you know about O-stars, you know there's a wind coming off of this thing.
You know, when we came up with this,
yeah,
with Ulmer,
yeah,
like 25 years ago,
yes,
years ago, we had a lot of resistance. I mean, people like Bodden-Paschinski dismissed the paper altogether. They
the
said
paper's
it's
right.
Yeah.
That's the
so
bottom line.
And Jeremy Goodman wanted to write a paper saying that this is not... That was 20 years
we
ago.
We should have encouraged him to do that.
He did that. He wrote it.
Anyway, I should be so smart for Jeremy.
One other quick question.
Yeah.
What are the temperatures in these winds? Why is it only electron scattering, not free?
It's not. It's resonance scattering.
That's usually much bigger.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's not much. It's usually about a factor of 10-ish bigger.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because the line's got to spread out, right? And like I say, the velocities are, maybe I have a UV spectrum in here. There weren't very many available, and there's just been a couple coming out in the last 6 months. That's why I'm kind of kicking myself, right? It looks like a Pisigny probe. That's what it is, right? And the blot, it's just an O-star. This thing's an O-star, right? Except it's got some extra gravity. And it's kind of big. And so 10 to the 44 versus 10 to the 39. It's 10 to the 5 times brighter. but it's an O star. It's like a Thorne-Zickel object, except, as you said, it's got all the mass down in the center. All right, but it's got wind, okay? So the mass in the wind, you can estimate, this is just crude estimates, right? You take the mass loss rate in the wind. Again, this equation is just, you know, continuity and spherical flow, right? And then I use this to get the density, so that's why there's not an R squared here, and the density disappeared, all right? So again, this is just measured. I don't know if you want to call that measured. I think that of that is a measured quantity, because it's black body radiation. We know how that works, okay? So this is all measured quantities, all right? So then if you just multiply by the time, right, where this thing's bright, you get an estimate. Well, that's just the radius of the wind divided by the velocity of the wind, and that's just the time that it's bright, essentially. You get an estimate which goes like 4 pi times the photospheric radius times the ratio of the wind, you know, the wind's moving out from the photosphere, divided by the photosphere, divided by electron scattering capacity. So this one keeps popping up, so I just define the mass at the photosphere. Okay, and it's about 3 by 10 to the 31 for that radius. Okay? And you'll see in a minute why that's useful. So in those units, the mass in the wind is just the photospheric radius times basically a factor which just depends on how long the wind's been going, and you get about 10 to the 32. Okay, and this is the time and the velocity. It's about 0.07 solar masses. And if you started out with a star that was 1 or 2 tenths of a solar mass, like I said, half of its bound, this is the bulk of the bound mass is coming out in the wind. Okay? All right, let's keep going. I got a couple of minutes. As I said, they're below Eddington or at Eddington, at peak. But of course, most of the time you see them, they're well below the peak, so they can't be at Eddington all that time. So you should use an Eddington model. So this is the paper that Abby was referring to, and it was 21 years ago. Abby.
21.
Okay, so then the density goes like 1 over R cubed. The entropy is roughly constant. So the mass of the pseudostar is just the mass of the photosphere times the log of the outer radius at the photosphere divided by some inner radius. So what's the inner radius? Well, at some level you don't care because it's only the log. But just say, suppose there's 10 times the radius of the innermost circular orbit of the black hole that's down in the center. Okay? Then that log's about 3 or 4, or 10 to 3 by 10 to 6 solar mass thing. And so the mass in the pseudo star is 6 by 10 to the 31 grams, or 0.05 solar radii. And that's when it's at the peak radius. Okay? And it scales linearly. Because I'm ignoring the logarithmic dependence there, right? So when it's smaller, the mass in that pseudostar is less. So what this is telling you is, first of all, it's less than the mass in the wind. It's also telling you that the mass in that pseudostar, first of all, it's varying with time, and you just infer it directly from the observations, if you think it's an Eddington model, which it is, okay? All right, so this makes that same point I made earlier, that you're actually blowing most of the mass out and very little is going down the hole. Well, a third of it maybe, some number like that. Okay. So you can check this with really simple theory, but I won't go into it yet because we're done. Yeah. If it's a radially driven wind, the mass loss rate is just given by the luminosity divided by the velocity of the wind divided by the speed of light. That's assuming you capture all the photons coming out. They scatter off of the wind at least once. This goes back to Josh's point. And the answer is, yeah, they more or less do. This FW is F factor. And if you look at O stars, that's about 0.75. If you look at Wolf-Rayet stars, it's actually bigger than 1 because you get multiple scattering. But it's of order unity, okay? So if you just take that, take the observed luminosity, and then integrate over time, the mass loss rate in the wind, I mean, the total mass in the wind is going to be 0.17 solar masses if you're at 10 to the 52 Hertz, which is the upper limit of these things. Okay, so you'll just remove all the mass that was bound around a hole. A little tiny bit of it, a third of it or a tenth of it, goes down a hole and dries everything else off. Okay? So in other words, most of the mass is in the disruptive star is blown away in a BAL wind. Okay? By most, I mean the stuff that was in the bound disk, the other half just left of its own accord, right? And that's just telling you mass loss rates in those stars. Don't worry about it. So the conclusions. The very profound one. The typical stellar mass is 0.2 solar masses. A star tightly disrupted by a black hole gives you these eccentric orbits that I showed you at the beginning.
But internal shocks thicken the disk. Again, I was showing you that from that paper by Shiokawa. So I assume it forms a pseudo-star, and this was suggested by Abby. The accretion rate is sub-Eddington. And the reason for that is, Abby suggested it would be super-Eddington because he assumed that it was a solar mass star and used what was available at the time, and you would get something super-Eddington from that. So his star lived a little too long. Not by much. It drives a massive wind. Okay, that removes most of the gas. And the peak mass in the pseudo-star is a very small fraction of solar mass just by observation. Okay, and the mass in the wind is larger than that, almost, you know, aside from right at the very beginning, right? All right. So basically this solves the energy problem. If you have two solar mass stars that gets disrupted, you get a tenth of a solar, 0.2 I should have said, you get a tenth of a solar mass on initially bound orbits, you get rid of 70% of that, and you should see about 5 by 10 to the 51 ergs. And that is sort of the characteristic energy that you see in these events. Okay, so that's the conclusion of the talk. Thanks.
This is such a simple picture, and our PhD is written on this problem that do very extensive calculations. The rest of the community, or at least those people that worked on it for the past 2 decades, seem to argue for a very complicated story. How do they react to your conclusion?
Anybody here? This is only the second time I've told this story to anybody.
So why? Why
the answer is I don't know how they're going to react. I'll write the paper, and I'll send it out, and I'll see what people say.
Starting with an answer.
What's that?
Starting with the referee. That's when you first know what the community
is. No, we don't have to worry about referees anymore. You put it on the archive. Yeah.
Martin Elvis here tried to consider this for the quasar case.
Right.
And came to a very different conclusion. He came to the conclusion that there was not sufficient momentum that could build up from the opacity that was expected for the radiation field that's measured for a black hole object. That's a significantly different conclusion from you.
So I know, I talk to Martin all the time. So I wrote a paper back, even before you wrote your paper, in 1995, about broad absorption light quasars. Mm-hmm. And I argued in that paper that they were driven by radiation pressure, and there it's an absolute no-brainer. You just do what Josh was saying. You just look at the spectrum. Those troughs, I don't have a picture of it. I could draw a P-signing profile that people like over here. Here. P Cygni is a star. Even astronomers don't know that, right?
No, it's a supergiant.
It's in the constellation Cygnus, and it's the P, you know, you start with alpha and you go through omega, then you start with A and go to P. So it's not a very bright star looking at it, but it's a giant. And it's got this big wind coming off, and it shows profiles. So I'm going to draw P Cygni profiles from like a quasar. Normal quasar spectrum. It's very blue like these, because the temperatures are not that different. And they sort of look like this. They, you know, there's a bump, and there's another bump, and then there's a big bump, and there's a little bump, and then there's a couple of big bumps here, like that, okay? So this is my version of a quasar spectrum. This is at 1550 angstroms. This is 2800. This is magnesium 2 for the experts. One singly ionized magnesium. This is like carbon-3 and who knows what else. Aluminum, I forget what. There's funny things in there. This is carbon-4. This is silicon-4. Nitrogen-5, and Lyman-alpha. Okay, so that's a typical quasar spectrum. All right? But there is a subset of quasar spectra, which are called broad absorption line quasars, where the spectrum looks like this. It goes up like that, and then it gets cut off here, and it comes down and does something like that. So there's these absorption troughs below the continuum. And the interpretation of this, you see this in O-stars too, okay? In O-stars, they look a little different. The spectra have this big bump. They kind of go off very gently, and then they go like this and then recover like that, okay? So it's a slightly different shape. But the mechanism, what's going on here is if you just count the number of photons that got scattered here, you know what their momentum is, and you add up all the momentum in those troughs, there's plenty of momentum in those things to push a wind out. Done. So you don't need a theoretical argument.
So if Martin came to that conclusion, you got it wrong. Okay? But he was probably talking about X-ray observations rather than UV observations.
Both.
Anyway, don't worry about that. Right? This momentum, right? A photon, you know, it's got an energy E, and it's got a momentum, which is just E over C. Right? So if you take the derivative of this, that's L. You add up all the photons. So this P dot is L over C. That's the momentum coming out in the photons. You count up how many photons have been scattered here, and you add that photon momentum to the gas, you can drive these BAL winds. You make the exact same argument in this case. Okay.
They actually did it with a model. In other words, put in opacity tables and all that.
I did too. I solved the, you know, had a CAK model to begin with, and then we did one where we just added up lines. But you don't need a model. Right? That says there's enough momentum. You don't have to worry. Your model may not get the ionization state right, but you know how many photons are not there. And I'd rather rely on that than some physical model.
Okay, if I may stop the discussion a bit, there will be time later.
Okay, good.
We have another speaker, so
yeah.
We'll thank the speaker.
Second speaker, we're very happy to have Yixin Shi. Lily is a graduate student in theoretical physics under supervision of Andy Strominger. Her research focuses on rapidly spinning black holes, the Kerr-CFT correspondence, and today she will tell us about critical emission for a high spin black hole.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for having me here. So today I'm going to tell you about critical emission from a high spin black hole. This is work that we put up on archive on the very last day of 2017. It's done with Alex, who's here, and Achilles, who's a postdoc at UCSB, who used to be an Andy's student. So in this work, we analytically compute the broadening of electromagnetic line emission from the innermost region of accretion disks, which surround high-spin black holes. Okay, so here's an overview. I'll first give an introduction, then I'll move to an overview of the near horizon region of extreme Kerr black holes, as well as geodesics that originate, node geodesics that originate from that region and reach a far observer like you and me. And then I'll move to the main part of our talk, which is on the line emission from a black hole accretion disk. Everything will be done analytically. And then I'll present a model for a disk which obeys symmetries in the neck region. And finally, I'll conclude. So we live in a really exciting time. Now we have an unprecedented amount of data for spinning black holes. Many of you here are working on the Event Horizon Telescope, and in particular I want to mention XMM Newton, New Star, and SWIFT, for example, etc. Those telescopes in the past few decades have really propelled the area of research of RNI. And Laura Brenneman, who's at Harvard, is an expert in that field, and in 2013, she wrote a paper where she gave a review of black holes, and here you can see many of these black holes that she gave, which have very high spin. So this is all very exciting, and the situation that we have here is a fast spinning black hole, and then around it, we have an equatorial accretion disk, which is we assume to be thin and slowly accreting. And by slowly accreting, I mean that we assume the particles on the disk to follow circular orbits, so we ignore the radial component. So I don't exactly know what the corona is. If anyone knows, please let me know. But what I learned from astrophysicists is that the corona excites iron atoms on the accretion disk, and in turn, that the excited iron atoms emit, and that light can be observed by an observer which is very far from the black hole. So this situation is very complicated. In particular, when doing data analysis, you have to isolate data from contributions directly from the corona, from an intrinsic observer of black holes, galactic observer from the Milky Way, etc. I'm not an expert on this, but the whole situation is complicated that when you want to make a plot of your flux on the y-axis and on the x-axis, if you want to have the observed energy, then as we know, there's long broadening. So emitted RNI is at 6.4 keV, but it's broadened. However, there's noise both at the lower end and the higher end of the spectrum, like our speaker from last week, Aaron Carr, had talked about. So it's a complicated situation. And my question is, is there something that theoretical physicists can do? And the answer is yes. So near the horizon region of a fast spinning black hole, there is enhanced symmetry. And because of that symmetry, we're able to do a few analytic computations which traditionally could not have been done, which were done numerically. For example, Shahad, Achilles, and Andy have worked on computing the radiation emitted from fast plungers into a fast spinning black hole. And that it was done completely analytically. And also Sam, Alex, Maria, and Andy have worked on magnetospheres, which are described by equations of force-free electrodynamics. Again, these equations were very complicated and traditionally were done numerically, but they were able to do it analytically. And in particular, I want to point you to a sister paper that came out last year, observational signature of high spin at the Event Horizon Telescope by Sam, Alex, and Andy. And in this paper, they consider an isotropically emitting hotspot that orbits the fast spinning black hole. Whereas in the paper I'm presenting to you now, we consider a whole accretion disk. Okay, so what we do is we analytically compute the broadening of electromagnetic light emission, which originates from the innermost part of an accretion disk that resides in the near horizon region and is observed along the neckline. You might not be familiar with the terminology, but I'll show you a picture of the neckline later. Basically, it is a vertical line segment that's on the observer's screen. And what we find is a universal result. Okay, so I'll start with a brief review of the near horizon extreme curve geometry and the geodesics. In Boyle-Lindquist coordinate, the most general curved black hole has symmetry given in the form of 2.1. Notice that I'm using Hatter coordinates for everything, because later when I deal with neck coordinates, I'll be using unhatted coordinates. In physics, we simplify life by taking limits. So after we can take the extreme curve limit, A equal to M, and then use Barton-Horowitz coordinate to zoom onto the horizon. So the first R here on the left-hand side is assumed to be small. And when you do that, what you're going to obtain is the neck metric to leading order, given by equation 2.3. It's worth noting that compared to the curve metric, the neck metric has two extra conserved quantity. What I'm also going to do is to redefine the conserved angular momentum and conserved Cotter constant to make my equations look better. Okay, now. So back in 1968, Cotter had already figured out an integral equations motion that describe the geodesic equations in Kerr. Apart from 2.5, there are two more equations which describe the phi motion and the t motion, but I'm not presenting them here because they're not relevant to this project. But this equation is extremely difficult to solve. So it can be written in Jacobi elliptic functions, and traditionally they are done using numeric variance ray tracing method. But the good news is this can actually be solved analytically for emissions that originate in the near horizon region of Kerr black hole. And how you do that is to use matched asymptotic expansion, which I will briefly describe. This is first done by Achilles, me, and Andy. So in net coordinate, you can write the denominator r in terms of 2.8, and then this equation, this is a very complicated equation, but it can be simplified in both the near region, but near, I mean the near horizon region, and the far region. So in the near region, you have a simpler integral to do, which you can do analytically. In the far region, you also have a simpler integral, and you can match the solution to both integration in the matching region. So this method only works to leading order, but we do have a leading order analytic solution to the Kerr geodesic. And in summary, if you have an emitter in neck, such as the iron atoms that we're interested in, which are in the near horizon part of the accretion disk, and you have far observers like our telescopes, then solving the geodesic equation will give you an analytic expression. And this will be useful in the next part of my talk. Okay, so now I move to the light emissions from a black hole accretion disk in our computation. Okay, so the profile of light emissions from a disk of matter around a black hole is generally done using the method of geometric optics, first thought of by Bardeen and Cunningham in 1972. They define a redshift factor G, which is the observed energy over the emitted energy, and in Kerr coordinates is written in 3.1, where RS hat is the source, so that is the emission point. And what we do is we define impact parameters alpha and beta on the observer screen. So alpha and beta parameterize the observer screen, where alpha correspond to the phi direction and beta correspond to the theta direction.
Do you also include the Doppler effect, because that's separate from redshift, just due to the motion?
Yes, this is just due to the motion.
No, the redshift is due to the fact that the photons are to climb the potential well, but in addition there is a Doppler effect, which is separate.
So as you know, if we're in the equatorial, if the observer is near the equatorial plane of the black hole, then there will be a Doppler effect. But when you're viewing the black hole from head on, that's you cannot see that.
You're just restricting your attention.
No, that's not true. Okay. We are considering this, and in fact, there's a lot of complication in this, which I'll describe later.
But what you're calling redshift includes Doppler.
Yeah,
right?
It does. It does include.
It's the actual.
That's right. In fact, we cannot. So okay, this is a whole other story, but we cannot see light head on. There is a critical angle theta naught at 47 degrees. If you're below that angle, if we're viewing black hole below that angle, then we cannot see light that originate from an accretion disk that's in the horizon, near horizon region, and reach the far observer. We cannot see that. There's a restricted angle from which we can see that light. Yep.
So is the idea that the rotation curve in the neck region is universal?
What's universal?
Because there's no velocity term here, right? So is it
the velocity is US. That is.
So it's not just gravitational ray tracing,
it's
also
the... Yeah, this is the velocity of particle in the disk.
Okay.
So then if you have a bunch of geodesics, they're going to subtend a solid angle on the observer screen, parameterized by alpha and beta. And in particular, we can relate them through two Jacobians, first with lambda and q, which are related to the conserved angular momentum and conserved Cotter constant, and then to RS, the emission point, and g, the redshift factor. When you put all these together, then you can write down an expression for the observed flux, f naught given by 3.4. The extra ingredient here is the emissivity function. And this, traditionally, in most of the astro paper, what they do is to pick a power law or a broken power law to account for that. However, we have built as I'll present in the next part of my talk, we will, what we'll do is to find a disk model which complies with neck symmetries. And that symmetry will allow us to fix this emissivity to a particular form.
One other complication is gravitational lensing, so you can have orbits that go around many times before this.
Yes, yes.
So is
yes,
that included here?
Yeah, so there are more, yeah, there are more complications. We're doing the simplest case. The model that we'll be building is really a toy model. But the only thing is it complies with neck symmetry.
But you include gravitational lensing implicit here. The fact that photons move on.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
And what do you mean it's a toy model? I think this is what we're supposed to actually
say. I'm sorry, I'm calling it a toy model. It is a simple model, okay, I should have called
it a toy. It's not a toy, it's what we see.
But later you see, it's a very straightforward model.
If
which
it's a toy model, you won't get a PhD.
Yeah, you'll see it very soon.
This R hat at the observer. So
that's right.
This is the same one as in the Kerr-metric?
Yeah, yeah. This is just the distance.
You're assuming that the Kerr-metric is a good approximation from the source all the way to us?
No. that's not the case. So the Kerr approximation of do you mean the neck approximation?
Yeah, well, no. I mean you're using these neck coordinates that derive from the Kerr
coordinates. This is Kerr coordinate.
And that R is from the Kerr coordinate.
That's right.
And this is at us. This is what we're observing.
Mm-hmm.
So you seem to be assuming that this coordinate system is a good approximation from the source all the way to us.
So in neck we have neck coordinates without the hats, and in Kerr, like as long as we have a Kerr black hole in our space time, then we can describe the space time using Kerr coordinates, which is
but not too far from the black hole.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't look anything like Kerr. It's gonna start looking like FLRW.
Yeah, but there are GRs looking for it, so you're okay.
Yeah, in the far region, like when I described the method of mesh asymptotic expansion, in the far region, the Kerr metric, it becomes flat. The Kerr effect is not important anymore.
He's worried about
okay,
that.
So the first Jacobian is very easy to compute. You can just do the differentiation. However, the second one is traditionally not computable, because of our lack of method in solving the geodesic equation, but we did find an analytic expression from it. How we found that was first using matched asymptotic expansion, and second, also taking into account that dominant contribution to the flux come from the near, from the emission point being at the near region turning point. So that's why we can find an analytic expression, 3.6, which had never been found before. And because of that, we obtain a universal result given by 3.7. Here, beta is a function, an explicit function of G. I'm not writing it just because it's long. So the entire flux is given by an explicit analytic function of G. Here, the emissivity, I'm still leaving it aside, but it is a function of R. So you can when you integrate over, it just gives an overall factor. And what we found is a universal result that's independent models. So here I have some plots. I first bring
this,
yeah.
This vanishes outside the interval 1 over square root of 3 to square root of 3. Right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
yeah,
the plot. Yeah, I was moving to it. Yeah, okay. So first, look at the plot on the left. Here we have the black hole shadow, the parameterized by alpha and beta on the observer screen. And all emission from neck are constrained to appear on what's called the neckline here, okay? So here's the shadow, and on the right-hand side, I have made the plot for this, and this equation, the plot I made is for 3 different observation angles, and as Andy just mentioned, here, this value is 1 over square root of 3, and the top value here is square root of 3. It's constrained to appear in between the emissions. Okay, now I'll present the model, which is not a toy model, a symmetric model. So if we have a particle number current, we can write down a particle number current. For a disk, which terminates at ISCO, the expression I write down is given by J, which is rho, the particle number density, the number of emitted density. H is the Heaviside function, which fixes the accretion disk to terminate at ISCO, the innermost circular orbit. And the delta function fixes the accretion disk to be at in the equatorial plane. And finally, we have the velocity of particles in the disk. Now, if we assume the particles emit isotropically, then the local emissivity at the surface of disk is basically given by this rope that I have in my J. The next piece of ingredient is the most important from NEC. NEC tells us that there is dilation symmetry, which is generated by the Killing vector RDR minus TDT. Because of that dilation symmetry, we know that we must have uniform particle number density per unit proper radial length. And particularly, if you calculate the number of particles, which is given by a spatial slice of sigma mu, which is just the normal vector to the spatial slice in the future direction times the square root of the induced metric, sigma mu, j mu, and you do the calculation putting all the components, then you see it's proportional to the length of the throat, length of the disk in the neck region. That fixes our emissivity function to be given by 4.4. And if you take the neck limit of this, then to leading order, it's just 1 over m squared. Now, the disk, because the disk lies in the neck region, if you integrate over the whole neck length, then that's going to give you log epsilon, where epsilon is such that epsilon is just the deviation from extremality for any black hole. The choice of epsilon cubed is rather arbitrary here, but the reason why we make this choice is because this way we have the ISCO at an order epsilon. And you can say that in the extreme curl limit, the exactly extreme curl limit, this really blows up because it's log epsilon. But it's the slowest divergence that we can find. For example, if you have a real black hole of A at 0.995 m, then in that case corresponds to epsilon being 0.1. And log of 0.1 is just 2. Sorry. Yep. And now if I put every piece together, then the observed flux is given as a function of g in 4.6. In particular, this part is model independent, and the log epsilon comes from our symmetric model, which obeys the symmetry, the dilation symmetry in neck. So what have we done? We have analytically solved node geodesics that connect neck and far observers through matched asymptotic expansion. We have found a universal result for the flux F0 that originate from accretion disk in neck. This is completely independent of model. And we have built a model that obey dilation symmetry in neck. But what else can we do? One thing we've been considering now, working with Andy, Alex, Dan, and Delayla, is polarizations. So given, say if the light is initially had already been polarized in the neck region, is there a way for us to use neck symmetries to figure out the initial polarization configurations and then consider, you know, gravitational Faraday rotation, etc., and match it to the and then match it out to the neckline and see how the polarization is going to appear on the neckline on the observer screen? That's one thing we're working on. Another thing we're just thinking about is with jets. So we just learned from Michael and Johnson recently that jets don't appear as jets until they're quite far from the black holes. But what we're thinking is perhaps inside neck, there's some kind of loading mechanism onto jets. So we're still thinking about that. Yeah, and thank you. When I think about that.
So I didn't follow the last bit where you said that you could get a universal emissivity profile.
It's not the emissivity profile that's universal. The emissivity profile is dependent on our model.
Okay.
But for any model that obeys neck symmetry, it should have the same emissivity.
I guess that's the statement I don't understand. What exactly are you saying?
What's universal?
Yeah, what exactly is universal?
So this is the emissivity is this thing multiplied by an integral over the integral over emissivity. However, this factor here is what's universal. And the emissivity just contributes an overall factor. So
it's
what
a
I'm
normalization.
Saying is, that's right. That's
okay.
So G, this function of F as a function of G is universal.
G is like velocity shift or redshift. Right?
Redshift, that's
okay,
right.
So this is the part that I'm having difficulty understanding,
okay.
Why this should be universal. Because, you know, this radiation is coming with some, you know, corona is irradiating it. There's all sorts of funny stuff going on there. How can
that's
you just
right.
eliminate all that physics and say that finally I just have one function that doesn't care about anything else?
So I'm not considering emission from the corona, but an equatorial accretion disk. And for any emission from that equatorial accretion disk inside NEC, this is the result that you will get. It is a universal result.
When you say universal, universal in terms of what? Like, if you vary some parameter, it's universal.
She's saying if you vary anything, only the coefficient, the normalization
yeah.
will change. But the shape will always look exactly like this.
I'm saying if you, regardless of the model you're using, for example, there's Novikov Thorne model, which is very famous in astro literature. Even for that model, regardless of the model, the dependence on G will be given in this form.
This will be the shape of the iron line curve.
Okay, so the shape of the iron line is universal. That's what you're
saying.
That's
the shape, yeah.
The normalization can be dependent on astrophysics,
that's
but
right.
the shape is universal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
so does it match simulations? So
we haven't done simulations.
Well, it must
but
if this is the correct result.
If it doesn't match simulations,
yeah,
it means we made an error.
Yeah.
Right? I mean,
I'm
false
not able to understand
yeah.
this physical
simulations
yeah.
are wrong.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah.
Far be it for me to put any stock in simulations. But.
Yeah, but one important point is that we are only considering the portion of accretion disk inside
yeah.
NEC. We know that there's the accretion disk is big and goes outside of NEC. So,
but
yeah.
so the ISCO for
mm-hmm.
if you're at a high spin case like A equals one, then I think in Boyer-Lindquist coordinates everything is at one RG, right? So you've got the ISCO and the event horizon is all at the same coordinate level, but they're at different.
That's right.
And they're infinitely far
yeah.
away.
Exactly.
And
yeah.
yeah.
So this
yeah
is
in the talk, Alex.
This is a test of how good your numerical code is. If you can reproduce this. I'm not joking.
It's exponentially it's exponentially
yeah,
difficult
yeah, yeah.
to reproduce this because as you get near this fixed point, you're probably just using a few grid points on this region.
Mm-hmm.
As you get
mm-hmm.
near the fixed
mm-hmm.
point, the physical volume of this region goes to infinity, and so your computer will have a very hard time.
You should make a strong statement that this is also a test of observatory that claims to see.
Okay. How about this? If your numerical code can verify this, I will give you $50. And Shep, if you can see this with your observatory, you give me $50.
Yeah.
Well,
but
sounds like some golden handcuffs to me.
That relies
on
the
sign.
What about you? I get nothing. I'm just
impressed.
Right, but if A is not near unity, it's not.
Yeah. But
you
see, here's the question. So when at the beginning of the talk, you showed some nice work by Laura Brenneman, where she was showing spins that were not quite one,
right,
unless I
right.
mistook that, right? So and being off even by 0.01 is pretty far off from
that's
one, right?
Yeah.
So there you could do some numerical stuff. And how applicable is this result to those cases?
Yeah,
in other words, do you have to be at A equals 1 before all that takes shape? And as you leave A equals 1, how applicable
yeah,
it is that?
The precise answer is hard to give because we're doing perturbation expansion and deviation from the spin.
Mm-hmm.
And to say when your perturbation expansion breaks down, what you're supposed to do is compute the next order term in the perturbation and ask when does that get big. And we only do the leading order calculation, which is very, very hard. You'd have to go to subleading order to say when it breaks down. But 99%, that should be good. You know, the further out you get, yeah.
When you say 99% should be good, on what basis do you say that, given that you said you can't compute anything?
Well,
you can compute it in principle.
You could compute it in principle. It's very hard. There are certain things which start to get bad once you get, there are certain sanity checks that you can do on the calculation, and if you, there's a parameter epsilon which controls the deviation from extremality, and if you make it too large, at some point you get results which are obviously not sensitive. So,
yeah, that's
So if you do that, I'll give you back the $50 you're going to pay me when I figure it out the other way.
So one of the assumptions that you made was that the emission is isotropic.
Yeah.
Right, but I would think that physically speaking, it's natural to assume isotropy in the rest frame of the emitting material. Because if you go to an atom, you know, even there you have some structure. Yeah, exactly. But definitely not if the atom is moving close to the speed of light. I mean, so the emission is beamed.
It's isotropic in the rest frame.
Yeah, exactly.
So
it's
which,
in the
is it in the rest frame
the,
that you're saying?
Yeah.
The assumption?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so
okay.
The particles are moving
so
at
you
speed
do have
U.
Beaming. You have beaming.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Yeah. However, the situation is really very complicated. As I learned, accretion disks are not generally a thing. So, yeah, this is ideal case.
Okay, listen.
I just wanted to add one thing to with those. I found it very striking that there's this bizarre maximum blue shift. So actually, most of the stuff that comes out, we thought in the beginning, when you get near the horizon, everything is going to get redder and redder. But in fact, it gets bluer because the Doppler shift is more important than because they start going around fast. The Doppler shift is more important than, and there's this bizarre absolute maximum for the blue shift.
How much is it?
It's 11.2 kV. Is that what it is?
Yeah, so it's square root of 3 times the iron line energy, which is 6.4.
It's 6.4 times square root of 3.
That's right.
Yeah. And so if you have, you might look up in the sky and look for, you know, spots that are emitting not at the iron line, but at the iron line times the square root of 3. Seems like a very...
Nothing like that's been observed.
What?
I mean, who knows? But you may. We certainly know 11.4 kV emission lines in these systems.
But in the system, it'd just be a black hole.
Sorry.
You might not see anything else, right?
Well.
I'm saying first, like, there's a lot of noise, and also at the same time, it's possible that outer region of accretion disk. Have a lot, you know, the emission is so much higher, like the actual number of photon you count is so much higher that even when it's a peak in net, maybe it's just a tiny peak that we can't observe in our data.
No, but certainly the Brennerman curves have blue peaks.
They have blue shifts.
Yeah. And they go, and the maximum is a function of the angle. So things kind of like this, aren't they?
Well, that does raise the question that she was asking. So what is the emission measure in this region? Do you have you tried to calculate that? In other words, how much stuff is there actually emitting in here? Because
the emission measure
is really small, you won't see anything. Right?
So that's it. Whether these effects could be big or not, this divergence is actually a good thing, not a bad thing. So in an idealized world where you have an extreme black hole that has an accretion disk that goes all the way to the bottom, you actually see an infinite amount of energy coming out. And that's not unphysical because it would take an infinite amount of time to feed. So something will cut this off.
Right.
But the fact that the leading order approximation gives you an infinite result lends hope to the idea that in the real dirty world, there still could be something.
Yeah.
You could scrape out under the dust.
Okay, thank you, both of you.